In this video, you'll learn about the impact of trade unions, government, and monopsonies on labor markets. Initially, we learned about the perfectly competitive labor market and studied this diagram. We are going to use this as our basis for analyzing the impact of trade unions, government, and monopsonies. Let's start with trade unions. Trade unions are organizations of employees who join together as one group in order to improve their working conditions. They negotiate issues related to pay, work expectations, job security, and the work environment. If trade unions are successful in negotiating a higher wage rate than the market wage rate, this could be of benefit to some of their members. As the wage rate rises to WTU, there's an increase in the quantity supplied of labor. This is seen by the increase from Q star to QS of workers willing to supply their labor. However, there is a contraction in the quantity demanded of labor from Q star to QD. This is due to the higher wage rate and its impact on the costs of firms. The situation we find ourselves in is an excess supply of labor. This would result in unemployment for some trade union members. However, this increase will still benefit those workers who were hired, quantity QD. The impact is similar with government intervention, specifically the minimum wage. Minimum wage set by the government is a legal minimum employers are required to pay their workers. There are different reasons for why these are enacted, some of which we will discuss here. The government may mandate a national minimum wage to reduce poverty and improve workers' living standards. By earning higher wages, living standards improve for workers. The minimum wage can also serve to reduce inequalities that may exist in the distribution of income. By forcing firms to pay out more to workers as opposed to shareholders, some income inequality can be reduced. However, a higher minimum wage could actually result in greater unemployment. Let's see why. This is exactly the same diagram as before, except for the reason for the higher wage is a government-mandated minimum wage. If it is set higher than the equilibrium wage rate W star, it will result in excess supply and thus create unemployment, but will still benefit the QD quantity of workers who receive the higher wage. Now we move to the impact of monopsonies, which are essentially monopoly buyers of labor. If there is a single employer in an industry, they have significant negotiating power when setting wages. Consider the case of a remote coal mine where workers have limited alternative employment opportunities. The monopsonist can exploit labor by taking advantage of the situation. To understand how this can happen, let's take a look at how wages and employment are determined in a monopsony scenario. If the mining company is looking for employees, they would need to offer a wage to attract the first worker. There may be one person they could get to offer their labor at a wage rate of $10. So their total cost for one unit of labor is $10, and their marginal cost of labor for the first worker is $10. But something interesting happens when they need to hire additional workers. To get another worker to offer their labor, the mining company needs to offer a wage rate of $11. This means they need to pay the new worker $11 and go back and adjust the first worker's pay upward by a dollar. This results in a total cost of $22 and a marginal cost of labor of $12. We get the marginal cost by subtracting the total cost of one worker from the total cost of two workers, and then dividing that number by the change in the number of workers. The change in this case is one worker, so we are dividing $12 by one to give us a marginal cost of $12. To hire a third worker, they need to offer them $12 and also go back and pay the second and the first employee the new higher wage. This means their total cost of labor is $36 and their marginal cost is now $14. To attract a fourth worker, the firm needs to offer $13 and similarly pay that to all of the previous workers, bringing their total cost to $52 and their marginal cost to $16. To bring in a fifth worker, the firm must offer $14. The total cost of labor is $70 and the marginal cost increases to $18. The sixth worker requires $15 to offer the labor, and that would bring the total cost to $90, as each previous worker must be paid the new higher wage. This results in a marginal cost of $20. Another way to see this is to see the marginal cost as the additional payment to the sixth worker, which is $15, plus the $1 increase each of the five existing workers receive. In a competitive labor market, we would expect the equilibrium wage rate and quantity of employment to be determined by the market forces of supply and demand. This would result in an equilibrium wage rate of W1 and equilibrium level of employment of Q1. However, in the case of the profit-maximizing monopsony, they will employ where marginal revenue product is equal to marginal cost. This occurs at Q2. We find the wage rate offered to all workers by dropping down from the intersection of MC and MRP to where it hits the supply curve of labor. The monopsonist will offer a wage of W2, which corresponds to a level of employment at Q2. Remember, workers are not paid wage W3 or equivalent to their MRP. This is due to the monopsonist's labor market power. But now suppose a trade union forms to challenge the monopsony. This results in an interesting turn of events. If a trade union sets a wage of W1, then the marginal cost of labor is equal to W1. Each worker will cost the exact same. Therefore, the firm will employ with a negotiated wage W1 is equal to marginal revenue product. This happens to occur at Q1, resulting in greater employment with a higher wage rate. As long as the negotiated wage rate is between W3 and W2, the level of employment will increase. If the trade union negotiates a wage rate above W3, they will decrease employment. The ideal range is between W2 and W3. Using the information in the table provided, how many workers should this monopsony firm employ? Pause the video and proceed when you think you've got the answer. The correct answer is 6. If the employer wants to profit maximize, they should employ the quantity of workers that results in the situation where the MRP is equal to the marginal cost of labor. In this case, it happens with 6 workers hired, and each worker will be paid a wage of $15. By now, you should have a much better understanding of the impact of trade unions, governments, and monopsonies on labor markets. If you found any of those diagrams particularly challenging, leave a comment as to why, and let's discuss it together. That's us done for now, and I will see you in the next one.